Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor once again to speak at the Commission on behalf of my country and that of the Pacific Islands Forum. When we met last year, we never imagined a world ravaged by COVID-19, which we have now. As summarized in the film study, while the Pacific was largely spared by COVID-19 due to our swift containment measures, it has devastated our economies, particularly the services industries, tourism, retail trade, hospitality, and civil aviation. And if I might add, it also severely affected the fishing industry, on which many of our small economies are dependent for protein and revenues. In reality, COVID-19 has exacerbated the persistent vulnerabilities and dependencies that continue to challenge our Blue Pacific. And I commend ESCAP for highlighting many of these. Low social protection coverage and the fate of potential beneficiaries in the Pacific Islands is an important indicator of vulnerability to pandemics and economic and climate-related shocks. Financing universal social protection coverage is smart investment, and I recognize the need for the Pacific to look at how we can benefit from the action plan for the strengthened regional cooperation on social protection in Asia and the Pacific. As a leader of one of the smallest and isolated of countries, I also appreciate the importance given to the role of connectivity and transport. Low digital and shipping connectivity in the Pacific Islands makes us particularly vulnerable to trade fluctuations and other restrictions caused by the pandemic, and has led to the prioritization of the digital economy by our forum economic ministers. This is an area we need to intensify our cooperation with Asia, given the dominant role it plays in trade, shipping, and ICT. The fiscal responses of the Pacific small island states to COVID-19 are small despite the severe impact of COVID-19 on tourism. But at the same time, this may be putting several of our governments at high risk of public debt distress. The point here is that the small island economies have limited capacity to respond to externally driven shocks, be they pandemics, financial crisis, or climate-related disasters, and should be given special consideration in accessing finance and debt relief. The FEAM study reminds us that Asia and the Pacific is home to extensive low-lying territories and small islands, developing states that are menaced by rising sea levels and extreme weather patterns. Impact includes more frequent storms and floods, escalating heat waves and droughts, and acidification and coral bleaching. Last year, as forum chair, I reminded the General Assembly that climate change remained the single greatest threat to the livelihoods, security, and well-being of the people of the Pacific, and that we should respond to COVID-19 in a way that promotes the well-being of people while accelerating global efforts needed to deliver on the Pacific, on the Paris Agreement's commitments, and more. Finally, effective responses to COVID-19 and to climate change necessitates much stronger multilateralism and regionalism in support of the 2030 agenda and the Samoa pathway. And we look to the Commission and the Secretary to ensure that regionalism in Asia and the Pacific is pursued in a manner that is differentiated and fair to vulnerable nations and communities. I thank you.